Hey, beloved friends, Jeremy checking in. I'm with Linde Ditmarson, a great friend and mentor in my life. And we are talking about the subject of love, the unconditional love of God today. And I wanted to open up with 1 Corinthians 13 from the Mirror Bible. It says in verse 3, "Love is not about defending a point of view. Even if I'm prepared to give away everything that I have and die a martyr's death, love does not have to prove itself by acts of supreme devotion or self-sacrifice. Love is large in being passionate about life and relentlessly patient in bearing the offenses and injuries of others with kindness. Love is completely content and it strives for nothing. Love has no desire to make others feel inferior and has no need to sing its own praises. Love is predictable and does not behave out of character. Love is not ambitious. Love is not spiteful and gets no mileage out of another's mistakes. Love sees no joy in injustice. Love's delight is in everything that truth celebrates." I'm going to read that one again because I love that. "Love sees no joy in injustice. Love's delight is in everything that truth celebrates." And the final verse, verse 7 says, "Love is a fortress where everyone feels protected rather than exposed. Love's persuasion is persistent. Love believes. Love never loses hope and always remains constant in contradiction."
Whoa.
I think that is a powerful truth, and it's one that I need to stay grounded in and rooted in, and I think you feel the same way.
I do.
You know, and there's when it says, love never loses hope and always remains constant in contradiction. Often I'm reminded of the things in my own life and in my own walk, and I'm sure you are too, where something comes up that feels like a contradiction to the love of God or the expression of the love of God. And that's what I wanted to talk about and dialogue a little bit about. That is, what is it that blocks us from fully expressing the love of God that we know is at work within us and being expressed through us? What is that for you? And I'm going to share about what that is for me. So I'd like to ask you, you know, when it talks about love remaining constant in contradiction and never losing hope, what circumstances do you feel your love walk being most tested in?
Well, you know, I think that for most of us, it's in relationships with our immediate family or with our loved ones, or maybe people that you work with closely. Everything's going to be tested in that area. And in that testing, if your mind is renewed, which that needs constant gardening, if your mind is renewed, you can stay in that place of peace that passes all understanding, and you can connect with Holy Spirit, which I think is the most important thing that we can do in a situation where you're being tested. All of this scripture says, love is predictable and does not behave out of character. Well, if you're in a situation where you have a challenge with someone, you don't agree, or you're in total disharmony, your job is to stay in character with God and the Holy Spirit and Jesus. Your job is to stay true to who you are in Christ Jesus, the hope of glory. And I think that's extremely difficult sometimes, especially when you're having a little tantrum, or as Jesse Duplantis says, you know, fit of carnality, I think he says. And we've all had them. We probably will from time to time. But the most important thing is getting back into alignment with who Christ is within you. And I think we've gotten to the point where even in the church, it's totally okay to be bashing people and to be starting these little coups against people, and it's not okay. We have to stay in alignment with Holy Spirit and what we have learned from Scripture and not veer from that. What do you think?
I completely agree. I guess I'm reminded of when you were saying that, I think of Jesus and all of the haterade that the religious folk of his day drank towards him when he was clearly doing what he saw the Father doing. And I'm sure in the mind of Jesus that he was doing what he felt the Father was showing him to do. And so that he knew when people were judging what he was doing, ultimately they were coming against the Father and the full expression of the life of the Father, the Abba of Jesus at work through Jesus himself. And I know that it sounds great. I mean, I can read it in Scripture. These are precious, powerful, potent promises from God. But, you know, when someone is up in your business, when they're making an accusation against you, stating their case, and they've got a very well-rehearsed structure of beliefs against you, they've made their case against you, whether it's a form of an accusation, it's just gossip, it's just, no matter how passive-aggressive it might be, I come back to the fact that I can't afford to have a thought in my head about them that God doesn't have, and I can't afford to think about my own life in a way that's contradictory to what God thinks about me.
Right.
And for me, that reels me back into love. And it's also sort of humbling when people come against you. Scripture talks about that they're also coming against the Father. You know, the Scripture communicates that we are the redeemed image and likeness of God in Christ Jesus. And nothing can tarnish that image unless we give it permission.
That's right.
And, you know, I don't want my lack of love. I don't want to be drawn into conflict and chaos and drama and crazy making. There's enough of it in life. I don't need to create any or sort of take the bait and co-sign anybody's bull crap, so to speak, because it draws me away from the simplicity and beauty of living by faith. And so I have to read the Scripture to keep my heart and my mind aligned with the intentions of God. And one thing I appreciate about our relationship and friendship is that we remind each other to kind of come back to that place of honoring and respecting the journey of someone else without judgment, and saying, you know, we see this person the same way the Father sees them. It's not always easy.
No, it's
you know,
not.
Thoughts are sort of, we got party crashers that like to sort of come in here, and they want us to live under the influence of them. And if we get under their spell,
that's right.
I'm talking about living under the influence and spell of a negative thought that's like a party crasher.
Yes.
They come into your house unwelcomed.
Yes.
They go into your fridge and they eat all your favorite food. and they don't want to pay rent, and they just come in and they just make a mess, and then they leave when they feel like it. I think Scripture, and I think, like you said, staying in touch with Papa and allowing the Holy Spirit to work within you keeps us in line and keeps us centered in what God would have us do in a situation, how we should respond. I think the spiritual leadership of Jesus tells us a lot about how to deal with conflict and resolve conflict. Sometimes he was pretty assertive. There's a time and a place for that. Sometimes he was sort of passive and just prayerful.
Right.
But the ultimate way that Christ resolved conflict was to nail it to a cross. And for me, it all goes back to the cross, that, you know, people may come against you. People may feel like they're entitled to indulge in anger that they're really not entitled to indulge in because it's based or rooted in a lie.
Yeah.
But you know what? We can't argue with other people's sense of reality. That's an impossible argument.
It really is.
You don't win win someone to love by argumentation. Anyway, that's like waging war on someone saying, "See, now you should love us." That just doesn't make any sense. Love is most intimately expressed in sacrifice, and sometimes that means taking it on the chin. Sometimes that means not defending yourself. Sometimes defending yourself means, again, giving credence to some argument that's just makes no sense. It's just not true. And I've experienced that in my life. I'm sure you've experienced that in your life. And I think most people have experienced that. But when the dust settles, I go back to this. I don't always think that my judgment or my evaluation of a situation or circumstance is at all accurate. I think that my perception can be very skewed when I'm frustrated or angry.
Yes.
Or when I disconnect from God. Especially when I have like this sort of religious relationship with God. And what I mean by that is that I just go through motions. I put some time in worship. I put some time in the Word. I put some time in prayer. but my heart's not there. This is more of an intellectual routine. I have to be in love relationships that help me to recognize where the breakdown is so I can become aware of the breakthrough that's possible. And I think in our relationship, we have the latitude and the levity and the relational permission that you have. You can confront me when I'm being a knucklehead. And I'm not going to say that you've ever been a knucklehead, but maybe a few times,
might have been once or twice.
But to me, we cultivate a relationship of accountability where you're free to jump into my business and step into my business and confront me when you see me deviating from the path of grace, from the path of love. And you do so with so much finesse because the love of God compels you. And we have that relationship and we give each other that permission.
Yes.
And I think that that's and I really think that for me, Linde has been such a profound influence on my life because she most authentically expresses the relationship that I see the Father having with the Son and the relationship the Son has with the Spirit. And it's like our friend Georgian Banoff said, it's like a Holy Ghost jacuzzi. We're in this love relationship and it really, it's safe. I can be authentic, I can be completely genuine, and I can lay my soul out and I can just say, hey, this is what hurts.
Mm-hmm.
This is where I'm wounded. It's not easy being vulnerable.
No,
I don't
it's
think
not.
For any of us, because it feels like weakness, or we feel like if I'm vulnerable, I'm going to give them ammunition to use against me in the future.
I know, and that's so sad. And it goes back to scripture where it says, love is a fortress where everyone feels protected rather than exposed. Love's persuasion is persistent. Love believes, love never loses hope, and always remains constant in contradiction. So I love what it says about love is a fortress where everyone feels protected. So if you feel like you're saying something that is making someone feel not protected, then you're probably not in line with what God wants you to do. We want to be able to have a conversation where everyone in our family feels understood. Now, does that mean we always understand everyone? No. But everyone does have the right to express themselves. And I think God and Holy Spirit and Jesus love that whole process with us, that you're fully capable and able to express you. You can be fully you and fully in Christ. And God says, I'm in relationship with you. And no matter how many times it takes you to understand the process that God's bringing you through to that place of more love, more freedom. He's patient. He is not sitting up there wringing his hands going, oh, Lindy's not getting it. She's just not getting it. And he's not in that place. He is loving me in my process, in my journey. And the beautiful part about it is that we can go to him even when we have not, when we've missed the mark, or when we haven't been thinking in line with him. We can just go and say, Papa, I don't think that I've been thinking in line with you. I think I feel really hurt. I feel really angry. I feel really ticked off at a lot of people. Okay, well, he can totally help you get into alignment with his love again, his beauty, his purpose, his sweetness. And it's not that difficult. It really isn't that difficult. I think we as people in our carnal fits make it very difficult. I just can't forgive. I just can't get over it. I just can't. There's just one thing I can never do. That is carnal. That is carnal. We can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. But in scripture, it talks about how we really do need to transform our minds. And in transforming our minds, we have to be in agreement with Holy Spirit. And sometimes we are not in agreement with Holy Spirit. We're in agreement with our own fits and our own little tantrums. And that's where we come in to challenge each other and say, are you thinking in line with what Scripture says? And having that relationship is so wonderful because, like Jeremy said, we love each other enough to tell each other the truth. And he knows I'm not trying to hurt him. I have his best in mind and he has my best in mind. So he can tell me what he needs to tell me. with his heart fully exposed, and I'm not going to use that as ammunition against him. That's not the way to go. It doesn't work. It ends up coming back towards you.
You are pretty gentle with me when you confront me, so thank you.
You're welcome.
It's like carefrontation, you know?
Carefrontation, I like that.
It goes back to what verse 3 says, that says love is not about defending a point of view. Love doesn't have to defend itself. Mm-hmm. It's just fully expressed. It's fully realized. It makes conversation safe. And I think that it's the Father's intention for all believers to cultivate these kind of relationships. But that means that each of us are going to have to find a renewed sense of courage and dare and take the risk. Be daring enough and be bold enough to be vulnerable and talk about what hurts us without pointing fingers. Because I think what happens for so many of us is that it would be easier for me to point fingers at you than to talk about what's going on in me. And, you know, in group therapy, and as a chaplain, we don't allow the pointing fingers and the you stuff. We talk about, say, make I feel statements. How do you feel? Expose that, share that, and let that come out. Because that's when everything's gonna, that's when you can unpackage. That's when you get that catharsis they talk about in that psychobabble terminology. And in our spirituality, in our walk with God, I think of it as just finally realizing how loved I truly am.
Yeah.
And I think for the time being, we're going to bring this video to conclusion. My beloved friends, I think we want you to be so encouraged, and it's our desire to encourage you. And I want to be clear, this Lindy is my mother-in-law and my mother-in-love, and I am her son-in-law's son-in-love. She is a spiritual mom, but she's also a best friend, a mentor, and has been a leader in our lives, and she would probably say we mentor and shepherd one another's heart. So I want to give her a big hug, just because that's how it is in our family. I hope you guys are encouraged. We love you and look forward to more of these videos on a regular basis. We will probably begin doing some live streaming in the future because we want to be a source of encouragement to you. We love you.
We love you. Be adored.